ready for the next talk. Professor K.L. Chopra is the ex-director of IIT Kharagpur. He's a material scientist, the founder of the Thin Film Lab at IIT Delhi and the Microscience Lab of IIT Kharagpur. He holds several Indian and US patents based on his research. Chopra is a Ratnagar Award winner.
Chopra is, if I may say so, a well-known disciplinarian. Our previous director, Dr. Manna, was from IIT Kharagpur, and always be concerned about what you would think. So I think
you
really
have
a great impact on a whole on a few generations of faculty. Warm welcome to the
presentation. Thank you very much. Well, pleasure to be here. There are a lot of things I don't like the IIT, even though I'm a part of IIT system since 70. I made a lot of changes in IIT Kharagpur. I don't go to the board, I don't go to the MHRD, I do it. And that's the way it should be by any good director. And I'm advising many directors to be brave enough to do that. Anyway, this is an area which has become very famous now. See, we are a scientific civilization, a learning society. And it's being powered, it's being driven, as a matter of fact, at a very high speed by knowledge power. So much so that everything is changing. The way we teach, the way we learn, the way we communicate, it's all changing now. In fact, there are only very few institutions in this country which are able to follow even a part of that thing. And that's probably some IITs, but leave alone. I mean, I also deal with NITs. I'm an advisor to several NITs, several IITs even today. But they are very reluctant to change, very reluctant. Okay. Essentially, most institutions in the country, universities including IITs, are more like largely teaching institutions. As somebody said, a university which teaches is dead. That was said long time ago. They are dead. We are in a learning process, learning society. And the results of that are very, very difficult to understand. And it impacts not only us, it impacts the whole country here. So in this process, we have to understand the knowledge. If it's a knowledge society, knowledge by itself is ethics neutral. It doesn't care. It's a search for truth. But the use of their knowledge and the user of their knowledge are not. And since it is becoming a really integral part of our society, I think we have to be concerned. All good Western universities are already so concerned. They start right from the undergraduate to the postgraduate. They all have to go through a course on ethics. And yet, our society has found it very difficult to even convince UGC. Only recently they formulated some policy. Ministry, they say it's not our business. Advisors, the Prime Minister tells me, Chopra, we are not, you don't become a policeman. And unfortunately, even the top people are involved in unethical practices. The topmost, now I leave it the name to you. Okay. So it's a very serious matter here. And well, this is something I'm doing even at this age here. Several IITs I'm involved with and looking at their cases. And of course, universities, you know, I mean, everything goes there. The poor vice chancellors are afraid to deal with them. Even the poor directors of IITs are afraid to deal with them. Oh, my colleague, we don't want a bad name. We don't want it. Okay. So this is what the problem is. Okay. All right. Okay. So what is ethics, really? I think the best definition was given by Mahatma Gandhi. Good or bad. That's what is good and what is... you know, goodness, essentially that's what ethics is. I think that was the simplest definition. Anyway, it's a science of moral values if you want to become more and more specific on that, between right and wrong, okay. it's not a religion. A lot of people think that way. And it's a, essentially, no civilization in the world would have survived without the ethic. The ethic means you have to learn to live together and so on, and have certain principles for that, okay? It's not a religion. And mind you, ethics are, they don't change. Ethics, moral values might change. Ethics value don't. I mean, there's a lot of correlation. Mostly what is moral is also ethical, but it's not the other way. It's not the other way, okay? I have to, okay. So let me define further. Universal ethics and moral values, I think, as I said, starting from the civilizations, dawn of civilization, there is a, this, without that, we would not have survived. Nobody would have survived. But everybody had, even the Eskimos today have their own ethics, for example. Every society has to have an ethics. Okay. So I've shown here the difference between, say, just an example here. For example, a bribery breach is a breach of moral values. But copying is a breach of ethics, for example. This is the main difference, okay. Now, obviously, ethics will be connected with whatever you do. Obviously, it's through a profession. But there are fundamental ethics, of course, all human beings, okay? There are personal ethics, there are interpersonal ethics, and so on and so forth. Professional ethics, and of course, there'll be basic ethics in science and technology, but on top of it, you have, civil engineers have their own specific ethics, mechanical have, I mean, these are more professional potential. So there's a whole range of these ethics, the domain ethics, the academic ethics. It's a vast field, okay. Okay, have I gone back or not? Okay, I see, okay. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm really. So, okay, I thought I'd start with this. What is going on? I think you better stand around me. Okay. I thought I. Ye to ho gaya. Ye to ho gaya. Okay. Interestingly, birth of ethics really started long, long time ago, 400 BC, and that is the Hippocratic. Not. You know, there are two words: Hippocratic and Hippocratic. Okay. This is the very famous 400 BC Greek Hippocrates, who is a well-known medical doctor, and named after him is this oath, which every doctor in the world today, even in India, every doctor has to do that. Okay. And just to give you an idea, you know what it says. It's a very long excerpt. Whenever they graduate, they take this oath. I swear by all gods and goddesses that I will help, not harm the patient, and so on and so forth. This has been a tradition in medicine, for example. Okay. Academic ethics, I think we don't appreciate that in this, particularly in this country, because when we say academic ethics, we always think of faculty and students only. I thought I mentioned that it's very important to understand that academic ethics is necessarily an institutional problem. You can understand if you get a bad image because of something in your registrars, like, for example, Anna University has got a bad name already because of that, or our students, for example, this gives you a permanent blemish on that. So this is something that every institution has to recognize, that it's not academic, it doesn't pertain only to the faculty and students, but it also pertains to the administration. They play a very important role. They play, and our alumni, because if alumni spread your wrong image, you are done. And see, we recognize Stanford or MIT because of their students. They are the one who really go back to this and even donate so much money here. But in our case here, if only student has benefited, he sings good things. If he has not benefited, he says, oh, what sort of institute is that? Okay. So this is very important. So there should be more lecture on these people also, but I won't. I will only talk about the obviously faculty and students largely on that. Okay. Oh, again it chalega. Acha, yeah. Arey, bhai. Okay. So academic ethics, I can list a lot of things here, and since the time is limited, I'll just only state few things. Okay. Obviously, it is important If you're ethical here, you know what to teach and how to keep your students involved in that thing. That's really also ethic. I mean, if you teach and it doesn't do good to any student, then that's really unethical, if you want to know the definition. There's no point in throwing things at a student here, and that's essentially what we do. We teach, throw things at students, and then expect every student to do the same, whether they're a good student, bad student, they must have scored the marks, and we help them to score the marks. Even IITs do that thing, unethical. In other words, nobody fails in IIT system. Very, 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 very rare for any student to fail in IIT system. If you give him second chance, the third chance, till he passes, right? Am I? I've been with IIT system since 1970, so both IIT Delhi and IIT. I've been dean, undergraduate, postgraduate, all sort of, and non-specialists. So this is. And of course, we never teach something like moral and honor. We don't teach about that. There's no discipline as such, and you heard some of the things today, okay. I think it is very important that all components of an institution, university or an IIT, must understand that they are a partner in progress of this, and understanding ethical practices. They have to be understood, they have to be appreciated also. And of course, an institute should promote these things. Should reward people here, and also reward, and also take the people who are dishonest. They should do something about it, which is very hard. As a president of the Society for Scientific Values, I tell you what I deal with a lot of institutions, including in the last year or two, 8 IITs I'm dealing with, and there are a lot of serious cases, a lot of serious. And every director is so afraid, what will happen? How can I do that thing? What will the Senate do to me? And so on. It is happening. And ultimately, some of them have pleaded with me, please come and save us. You become chairman, you write, we will say that Chopra did it, we didn't do that. Well, that's okay. So I had some faculty members dismissed. Okay, it's not okay. So I think all I want to say here is that we have to core values of justice, integrity, respect, we have to promote that. And everybody has to involve. And a brave director has to be a brave. All the management people have to be brave in this. Even head of department has to be brave. He should not say, this is my department, what should I do? We have faced that in all IIT Delhi. We faced it. Head of department says, oh, theek hai, thoda sa hai, kya kar diya, itna kar diya, kya ho gaya. I mean, he says, if director general or CSIR can say, oh, all right, I had only 4 pages copied in my book, so what? And you know what those 4 pages are copied? He says, it is my colleagues who copied it, which is even worse, that your book was written by your colleagues, not by you. Director General CSIR. Bharat Ratna also says the same thing. So it's not, not small people involved in it. Okay. So, also administration. So I thought I just point out that these are also important ingredients. I think we must respect them in the ethics. Because unless they themselves are ethical and they practice ethical practices in their pointing out where things are. Because they also, if the director or the dean say, don't do it, well, those poor fellows, do something to their whatever is written in the files here, or the files get destroyed or something. So that happens here. So practicing and promoting ethical code of conduct, they are the one who have to make sure that this is being practiced by students, by faculty and staff. They have to understand and prevent the abuse and misuse of power by the various authorities. That is even more important. A lot of people, particularly those directors who are in this trouble here, they seem to specialize then. Once they have learned, they tasted the blood, they think it's all right, you can do this and you can do that and you can do that, okay. I think it is the administration who should point out, should have the courage to point out that they are doing it. And they should do, obviously, practice confidential academic information. That also, is, of course, this is a typical Indian problem, the whole Indian. I mean, even the Prime Minister probably will not be able to and is not able to keep the secrets of his office. If he says this university, non-existing university, should become the highest level, but his office has revealed some or the other, I think by something has come out, that it was his order that it has to be done, a green field institution should become institute of international importance or whatever that silly word is. It's a sad story. How can a prime minister set up a university which doesn't exist. There's no land there, nobody exists. And on the last day, they appoint somebody as the president of the university. Okay. And they are not the only one. The brother of the same person, you got a university some years ago when BJP was in the government. And I protested all that. The university de novo, I don't know whether you know the word de novo. De novo was created by BJP government when they were in 14 days only in power. In 14 days, they created a number of universities. And one of them is in my mother. I don't know whether you, it's not a university. There are only four departments. You cannot have a university under four departments, but you're still running there. Okay, there's the other brother, Ambani brother. Okay, so this is happening. So somebody has to point out, but people don't have the courage to do that thing. So nurturing public image, of course, is extremely important. As you can see here, that if somebody takes you up and then spoils your name, and you know, the students also suffer, the parents also feel that this is something wrong. Okay. This is exactly what happened to IIT Kharagpur. IIT Kharagpur was the premier institute, the first institute, was top institute. It went down to, and this is when the government of India requested me. I was not recruited. I'm a physicist. Requested me, please save us, help us. We know that you are strong enough. And I said, I'm a physicist. I have nothing to do with the university. I don't even know where Kharagpur is. No, please. So Narasimha Rao requested personally, please help us. So I had to spend 10 years because of that thing, punishment. After 5 years, I said, no, we'll not let you come back. You have to do that. So it's cleaned up. But I think after I leave again, things start going backward. It's okay. So I see. Okay, role of students, of course, is also important. We must understand that they must be involved in understanding the ethics. Okay, because it's also is something we don't do that thing. We think students have come only for study, but this is important. They must be, first of all, we must welcome students. We must feel them welcome. They are part of administration. That's why they should be in the Senate, for example. They should be all the parties. We do invite them whenever we feel it is convenient. Not all the time, but we should. They should be there, okay. And we should hear them. Have they responsive teaching and learning process? Are they there? We talk a lot of things here, a lot of policies here. We are still a teaching university, including quite a part of the IITs. The whole world has gone to a learning process, not teaching process anymore. And it is the students now who are learning that when they go abroad, they do very well. And because they go into a responsible learning process. And this is something I think we should be hearing them. From any, we heard it this morning here, you know, some problems here. It is the students really we should speak out and say that we are not happy with this teaching, we are not happy with this faculty member, and we should take it seriously. And in a more civilized manner, not to punish them, okay. And of course, all their mentoring activities, extracurriculars, you imagine, I think they should be a partner in progress. They are the one who give you an image. These are the people who are given image to MIT. MIT gets billions of dollars or crores of dollars, rupees or dollars, okay, donations from these people. And it is the same people who, in the early stages of IIT Kharagpur, for example, they have done that. But the only thing is, I have to go there and tell them, I have to visit many of them, and it's the first time I got $2 million, the first IIT to get a $2 million donation, only because he said, I want to be involved, but your institute doesn't let me even enter. I said, I will open a school of management in your name. We know Gupta School of Management. Gupta School of Management, I think the first IIT to start a school of management was IIT Kharagpur. I started that. And I took $2 million and I got a warning from ministry. You have taken money in dollars without the permission of the government of India. I said, you go to hell. You send me to IIT Kharagpur. And now you're asking me, and I brought a check and I put it in the bank and then deposited. I'm not a parceling. I kept them silent there. I invited the President of India to inaugurate it, and then they said, well, Chopra is out of our control now. So, and then all other IITs said, if he's out of control, why can we not ever under out of control? So all IITs started School of Management only after that. So this only tells you that, you know, if you're honest enough, I think you'll be all right. Okay. Of course, they should be also involved in extracurricular mentoring activities. They should be involved. We design policies, we don't get them involved in. Okay. And of course, there is counseling and internships and so on. And I think basically they should be made partner in this progress. There is every course should have some component of ethics, for example, and they should be asked, what do you think of that thing? In fact, even teaching, we should be asking them, are you learning anything? See, in IIT and NITs, for example, nobody wants to, the students don't want to learn physics or chemistry. Particularly chemistry, they don't like at all. I'm sure you all know that. Physics, mathematics, they have to suffer. Some order, they know without that, they cannot do anything. Physics, they don't want. I have to go give lectures to God knows how many NITs have given lectures. Why physics for engineers? Why physics for engineers? But you know who's destroying it? It is the physicists who are destroying this interest in physics. Because you ask them to, do you give them experiment? You say, do Newton's ring? And I ask everybody, why are we asking them to give experiment on Newton's ring? What will he do? I asked the mechanical engineer, what do you, he said, I don't know. They told me to do that thing. Measure velocity of light. He said, it is all known. Velocity of light is this much. Why the hell I have to wait? I said, wait, measure the velocity of light for three colors. And then tell me what does it mean. And then tell me what is it related to GPS, for example. Only then they realize. So therefore, there is a fault on both sides. The faculty itself is very happy teaching whatever they want to, whatever they learned and modified a little bit. And so these are the problems, okay. Anji. Okay. Students, ये पीछे जा रहा है क्या क्या रखते हो आप लोग बड़ा फैंसी चीजें हैं लेकिन अच्छा आई थिंक दिस इज समथिंग हाँ जी प्रोफेसर साहब आई एम गोइंग टू से समथिंग लिटिल डिफरेंट फ्रॉम व्हाट यू सेड ओके दिस इज अ प्रॉब्लम नाउ वी ओल्ड यूनिवर्सिटीज आर ऑब्वियसली एज यू सेड गुरु शिष्य परंपरा दैट आई एम सॉरी टू से इट हैज नो मीनिंग टुडे. It has no meaning. I mean, it was all right, pursuit and creation of scholarship and teaching subject to classical rules of ethics. But when I say classical, I mean parampara. That's a classical. Things have changed. We have to understand. Now, university or IIT or whatever, academic institutions, they are really for pursuit of scholarship, all right, and teaching for learning, to learn, to create, and to translate multidisciplinary knowledge. Multidisciplinary. Very important here. We want to teach them a mechanical engineers say, well, it's our job to teach them mechanical. We don't want them to learn physics. We don't want to learn chemistry. That's a stupid thing here. There's nothing like mechanical by itself. There's nothing chemical by itself. There's nothing like physics by itself. No, they're all connected together, including biology. I introduced biology in 1987, 88 in IIT. And there was a hue and cry. I said, nothing doing. You got to learn that. And now they appreciate that. Now everybody has biology in all of their IITs. So they have to learn to create, to translate. Whatever they learn, they have to learn to translate now multidisciplinary knowledge. Now this is not the conventional knowledge that we were shown by quoted the MIT 150 years ago. I'm sorry, he quoted, that's okay. That was all right, fine, but it's no more. The university is a very different place altogether. Peter Drucker said, those universities are dead long time ago. So what we have to understand is now whatever we are going to produce, it has to be engine, it has to power the engine of economic growth. Whether we like it or not, this is what the world is working very hard. You have to do that, there's no question. And so, and when you do such a growth on international level, then you have to accept also globally accepted ethical values. That's also, if they are doing it, they say you cannot do this thing, then you have to learn to that. You cannot say that we are Indians and we will follow our Indian spiritualities and so on. You cannot do that. Okay. So I'll go over code of ethics for a faculty. I have several slides here. I will be brief on that thing. Basically, virtues are, say, integrity, honesty, responsibility, fair, impartiality, and so on. But most important is competence in the field of his or teaching, and not only competence, it should continue to build on it. Okay, it should be lifelong learning, and mentoring, supervising, grading of students should be without any bias, and on the basis of gender, psychofancy, regionalism. Unfortunately, it happens even in IITs, because you hear some of the universities. I think the Anna University has been in in news in recently, but some of the other IITs have been protected. I mean, because everything, they have a halo around them, so it's okay. But does anybody fail in IIT system? I mean, I found it very difficult to understand my IIT Kharagpur, and there were students who, I mean, you gave second examination, probably a third examination, still do pass. Everybody passes. Everybody. This is a very sad story, okay. And there are people, students who say, okay, at least I'm not doing well in computer science. I was a topper there. Why don't you let me go to agriculture? My senate said, nothing doing. I said, they will do it. We have no business with the man. The boy says, I want to do agriculture now. I think I've seen computer science. So I did allow them, but there are a lot of opposition. So again, I think this is something else. Flexibility of changing over. Have we given them a stamp forever that you are a mechanical engineer, you remain a mechanical engineer for your life? Incidentally, I'm a physicist. I've taught in mechanical engineering department in USA. I was a professor of mechanical also. So, I mean, they don't care. They say, doesn't matter what your degree is, as long as you can teach in civil or mechanical or wherever, you are a professor of that for that short time. What is wrong with that thing? Why don't we do that thing? So, and incidentally, I don't think these require rules, certainly not for IITs. IITs have a lot of autonomy, but it's not being used largely because the poor director is afraid of doing it. Because he's afraid going to Senate and then, well, you have to convince the Senate, all right. But it's okay. All right. Okay. Oh, what happened, bhaiya? Yahan to kuch bada kuch hota rehta hai. Kya ho gaya? Okay. Two. So, teaching and research only, I think this is also important. They must teach only in areas of their competence. Yeah, let them develop competence, but they should teach. This is something else. Whenever we are short of faculty, we say, arre baba, ye bhi padha do, ye bhi padha do. I mean, that doesn't make sense at all. Okay, I think. And publishing, well, I mean, whichever is a subject in, you know, news and something, they jump. Everybody jumps to nanotechnology today. Well, people like us have been doing nanotechnology since God knows what, since 70s or earlier. In fact, my first book written, published in 1969 by McGraw-Hill is a thin film, but it's all that's all nanotechnology. That's the basis of nanotechnology. But now everybody wants to do that. Even mechanical engineers are doing nanotechnology. Civil engineers also want to do nanotechnology. That's becoming very famous. This is how you get DST is very, you know, Department of Special Treatment. They treat you well. They treat you well if you put the word nano into it. 10,000 crores they have spent. And the secretary from your own colleague from here, they ask me, their friends, they say, Chopraji, what is happening? I spent 10,000. Where is the product? Well, how can you have a product when you import every damn thing? You import nano wires, you nano carbon, you nano everything you import and do experiment. You have electron microscope, something like an electron microscope. You change the size of the nanotube, the length or the diameter or something, the property change. So you can have properties, you can have a paper every day if you want to. Literally, I think some of you may not understand, it's very so simple. Because the properties at that level depend on the shape and the size of the material. So you can change the property. So no wonder Professor C.N. Rao can publish every day a new paper. Because he's got the most powerful microscope, and there are only four or five in the world. Okay. So you can do that, no problem. So publish quality research with proper credits. I think that's another problem that comes in. I mean, whether you work or not, I mean, the supervisor expects his name to be there, or co-supervisor, if somebody is giving you electron machine, his electron microscope, his name has to be there. So there is no proper giving a credits, okay. Share equitably credits and benefits of research, consultancy, technology, development, patents. It should be shared equally and honestly with your students. I would prefer that a student who puts in all the efforts should be given the first priority. He should have the first name, for example. This is unethical. And that's being done all over the country here. Whether it's IITs or universities or even much worse, the professor, his name come first, has to be. Professor is the one who sent the paper, and if it gets in trouble, then he says, no, I didn't do that. My students have done that. This is very strange. They say first name. So the first vice chancellor was dismissed. I won't name you. I think he was in big news here. It was largely because of us. And president, at that time, president of India, took a lot of interest in this. Abdul Kalam, for example, he took a lot of interest in it. And he said, no, I don't even remember. These papers were sent to Physical Review. They put my name in it. Well, your name is first. You send the paper. So ultimately, we had to find out where his app is. You know, when you send a paper, your signatures are there. So they, we had to find signatures and then show him. Then he resigned. Okay. Anyway, a faculty member has a responsibility to ensure the quality of standards, assurances, maintenance, and so on. This is also an important year. We don't worry about that thing. You know what the students are going through here, and there today is a very serious problem with the chemicals, for example, or any other danger from electrical, for example. In fact, quite a few students have died even in MIT using a transformer, not, you know, just bare wires, and somebody touches the wire, died. Okay, Anji, okay. कहाँ पे है? यहाँ पे है, ठीक है. नहीं नहीं, ये तो बड़ी जल्दी आ गया काम. ओके, सो आई हैव ए लॉन्ग लिस्ट. आई थिंक आई एम नॉट श्योर दी स्लाइड्स हैव बीन गिवन टू यू. आई थिंक माय स्लाइड्स इज द राइट. ओके, सो दीज आर देयर, बट आई विल जस्ट ब्रिंग आउट द मेन फीचर्स हियर. ओके ओके, ही शुड नॉट बी इन्वॉल्व्ड इन द मिसयूज ऑफ फंड्स, करप्शन एंड किकबैक्स. नो, this may sound, I don't know how many of you understand that thing, because I've been a dean of R&D, dean of postgraduate in IIT Delhi. I've seen quite a bit of it, and I had to investigate. You see, today, even today, to get the projects from funding agencies, if you know somebody, your chances are very high. Okay, and there is always somebody there, and it is much worse in defense, DRB. If you know somebody, okay, we'll get you. But when the clerk passes the bill, he asks 10%. Generals of army of this country have asked my student, who has a company, he wanted to give technology on producing oxygen in the plane itself. They said, how about over 10%? So I'm giving you examples, I mean real examples. So this is a kickback, simple. To get a project here, you have to keep somebody happy there. And they will speak something. Even the clerks seem to have a major role even in our funding agencies, okay. They put it in a proper way that this is a very important project, sir. It must be approved, okay, all right. And of course, reports is a problem. Some of us now, you know, I'm too old now, but even sometimes I'm called by the DST, ye kya ho raha hai? Even in IIT Kharagpur, kya ho raha hai? This man has given a report which makes no, he says, please study that thing. And he says, laser will do this thing and laser will bomb out everything else. And the power of the laser is so little, how the hell it can do that thing? And I unfortunately had to give recommendation against the person here. So what I mean to say is that we do all the thing here, we decorate the reports here. We decorate the reports here, and who's going to verify in DST? The clerks look at it and say, yeah, yeah, report is good, looks very good, colorful pictures are there, of course, that's very easy. So these are, on these basis, of course, you get all the promotions, appointment, recruitment, I think that you know that. So don't think necessarily that the Bhatnagar ward is the top, but I'm also Bhatnagar wardi, okay. But I didn't even know that somebody has nominated me Bhatnagar ward. Of course, that was 1975. Somebody called me in the evening, oh, you got a Bhatnagar ward. I said, what is it? I said, don't you know that? I didn't even know that, okay. Now, the people who have their name there, they keep calling you. Hare, Chopra ji, you are a member of the committee? Will you please help? See, this is a very sad story that we are getting, okay. Also, you know, if you have conflict of interest, you don't accept the role of an expert. And there are many, unfortunately, do that thing, okay. Political interference is plenty. I don't know what level you deal with it, but there is always some message somewhere, hey, that looks a great project, that looks great, the man. And why should, I mean, a project supported by a minister of science and technology says, a fellow is dropping sand from a height, and when it comes to sort of friction is there, charges are collected, by the time it ends up, there's some voltage there, right? And this fellow says, I can draw powers out of it. Such a cheap way, sand, I call. And it comes to me, I said, it's nonsense. And the ministry said, you dare not write word nonsense. He's going to the minister, okay. So I said, what should I do? You do whatever you want. Project was given to somebody. Can you believe that thing here? So these things are still happening. And of course, whistleblower. If you ever have a bad luck and you blow up something, you could be in trouble. I think, you know, the government of India is sitting on a whistleblower act for the last 10 years, okay. They don't even approve that thing. Okay, it's okay. Tell you. All right. Okay. These are 10 commandments that I made. But anyway, I won't go into it. But these are simple, straightforward. I don't have to say these are truth, honesty, trust, independence, originality, dissent, tolerance, objectivity, justice, openness. All these things should be taught to our research students. They look simple, but I think they need explanation. Whatever you say, it should be trustworthy. He should be able to say, yes, you can verify that thing. Okay, so I won't elaborate that any further on that. This is done. Okay, now I thought I'll go the other way. Instead of the ethical, I say look at the unethical things so that you can have a little bit better appreciation. These are, of course, well-known names, you know, plagiarism. Plagiarism is very, 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 very common today throughout the world. And the countries which are on top are China, next is India today, in number of plagiarized papers and so on. There are other countries also, it's not. Mind you, other countries are involved in other types of things, like USA and Japan are top in patents, for example, stealing patents. So it's not that we are the only dishonest. There are other people dishonest too. Okay, but falsification of data, fabrication of data. You know, unfortunately, this power of knowledge is being used very, very, very wisely, thanks to the mathematicians, right? Okay, that you have given us the computers and how to manipulate the dating information technology. I had a student here, he was doing nothing, and all of a sudden somebody tells me, this fellow has published a paper in Journal of Applied Physics. I said, how? I look at it, he's taken somebody else's paper, all he has changed the figures there, data, and figures are changed, and said, my God. So I threw him out of it. Okay, but it's so easy. And this is thanks to the computers and other means. You can fabricate any paper you want. You don't have to do the work. Okay? Yeah. And then on top of it, you can purchase publications. And these are available. I mean, there are people who send you a newspaper, an email. Okay, you want a thesis to be written on this subject? This. Even in USA, in Times of India, Times the magazine, you will see advertisement. You want a paper on this biosciences, you want to be first author, pay this much. You want to be second author, you pay this much. It's there. I'll show you some examples. So it's not just being done here, it's being done even in US. Okay. So authorship is can be purchased. And if you happen to hold a microscope, electron microscope or something in your hand and control, and you let somebody use, you say you better put my name on the paper. Delhi University is some of the most terrible people there. All departments, you use their equipment here, you have to put their name. And the vice chancellor is helpless. I'm shocked what a vice chancellor cannot do. He's so afraid of the unions and so on, he won't do. It's very common. People from CSA labs, why did they set up an academy? Because of this. Because any of the CSA fellow wants to register for PhD in Delhi University, it's a written sort of order here, their name of the supervisor, whether they do anything or not has to be there. Okay. So these are ghost authorships, and authorship of sleeping executives, and some people call them white bull authors. This is the American word, white bull authors. Okay. Sequence of course is also a problem. The tragedy is then the sequence. Of course, now the journals are becoming clever. They say what a contribution you have, what percentage you have, but that also is being fabricated. Of course, the poor supervisor tells you that put down my 30% or 40% and so on. But this is very common. IITs, it's common. IIT should be the best example in the country here, but they are not. But some other, because we are so big now, the poor deans don't have the power. The director poor is afraid to do anything. I think there's something has to change. Okay, figures and images. This is typical in biosciences. Where you can change any image, and we have caught some people, very senior people here. You can publish the same paper in any disease, modify this thing a little bit here, black and white change, and do whatever you want to. It's becoming common. Okay. All right. Am I doing a little too fast? Okay. Ani, please. Piche. Well, globally, at the moment, there are about 10,000 open access paid journals. These are not predatory journals. I think that's in big news. We've been fighting with the UGC for the last 5 years. Please ban these predatory journals, okay? They don't seem to understand different. Now, recently, they've issued an order, but that also is, they have not understood at all. There are 10,000, can I have one? There are 10,000 open access paid journals. In the world today. Out of that, I think some few thousand are only in India. India and China has about close to 7,000. You know that. You can publish anything in 3 days or 4 days. All you have to pay is a few thousand rupees, right? Whatever you publish. They're very clever. They get from you a certificate saying my work is original. So when you complain, they say, you got a certificate from the author. So, all right. If you tell them this is already published somewhere else, they say, okay, retract it. They put a word, retract, but they have already got 4,000 rupees. Okay. This is becoming extremely common, and well, the whole world is concerned about it. Okay, but they are not the only one. I mean, even the big presses like Elsevier, Wiley, Springer. I've been editor of Elsevier journal for a long time. I resigned from it. I said, what the hell are you trying to do here? You also have a journal where even AIP, American Institute of Physics, they publish papers of conferences, but they don't get it reviewed. They simply say it has been reviewed by the conference people. Well, no, conference people don't. I mean, I've also run a lot of conferences. There's never a time to review that thing. So this is another thing that is happening in the old country, particularly ours, because there's a conference every other week, I think, and I mean, every IIT has to have some 10 conferences a year. So the total number of conferences is in thousands, and they all get published, and everybody quotes that I have published a paper. You know, out of these predatory journals, just to give you an idea, I think if you don't know this thing, there are 6,000 journals out of these 10,000 from India. 6,000 journals. And do you know what address they gave? They gave Florida address, some other address. But they're running from Motinagar in Delhi, next door to my, I mean, living in Kirtinagar. Small one room, computers are there. In fact, there's one famous one. In Hyderabad, they have 1,500 journals being published from one room. Omics. And a lot of people publish in those because every journal there starts with international journal of this thing, right? International journal of this. They put 3, 4, 5 subjects into it, international journal. So I think Gurgaon has IJR. I think that's the one which has the international. Everything is international, okay? So I think. They pay 500 rupees to UGC, MHED to get the ISSN number. So you are very happy to see ISSN number, ISBN number, you know, because everybody quotes my paper, my journal is ISSN, my book is ISSN, but actually it doesn't cost you anything. The clerks don't care. I think they probably get another 100 rupees on top of 500 rupees and they give you the number, okay. So we've been complaining, my society has been complaining to ministry and UGC for the last 8-10 years. And now recently they've issued a notice. Yeah, and they said, you know, some of the journals should be banned and so on. But they don't understand it. You know what the UGC says? Up to 10% you can plagiarize and there'll be no penalty. I don't know how many of you read it. They're so stupid. 10% up to that is okay. They don't even. And we can give you journals where even one sentence is critical. Even one sentence is critical, but they don't understand. So we objected, we give them reform changes in it, but they don't listen to us. Okay. So there's all right. Oh, I'm doing a bad. Just to give you an idea on these predatory journals, everybody's involved. Everybody, IITs are involved. Can you believe that thing? IITs are involved. I see 11% papers in these journals come from national institutes, which are IITs, NITs. So NITs at 11%, NITs, IITs at 9%. 20% of the papers are coming from these papers. Can you believe that? This is not my data. This is somebody else's. IIT source is also given here. Of course, CSIR is a lot, ICAR is 20-17%, okay. State universities are a lot, private universities, of course, the maximum. That's the maximum. So everybody is involved. So it's not, it's a global phenomenon. I just give you quickly, people are not afraid to go to Time magazine and advertise that, please come to us, we'll get you a PhD, we'll get you this, just pay this much. But there are journals now where the retraction watch is there, Springer, for example. And interestingly, they have given even rank to these people here, the topmost author of plagiarized paper. And that's happened to be a Japanese, Fuji, 183 papers. And Muralidhar, he says, I should give it more on academic ethics. So anyway, just to give you that we are not the only one. Here is a very major inquiry going on. How many billion dollars are the US has spent in biosciences and human genomics, and they have got nothing out of it. I have just written there, I think it's unfortunately cut somewhere, I think, is that our IIT, our DST has spent 10,000 crores or more. This is what the DST secretary tells me. And on nanotechnology, there is not a single product. Although on papers we always claim that we have purified, we have this, managed to purify water, and where is it? So the tragedy is even the simplest thing, like even soldering iron we import. Even slides, glass slides, coated glass slides, connecting glass slides we import today. Everybody gets their money and imports. So this is really what this was meant to be. Okay. I'll skip some of these. Okay. We, as I said, our society points out these things to the vice chancellors and directors and so on. And interestingly, some of them come up with very interesting replies and say, well, really, it's not guilty of manipulation. It was only small words and small sentences. I've quoted it. He's a good scientist and he has already suffered enough. Don't bother him, please. All sort of thing. So, we have replies from a variety of people here. I think our honor and reputation is in at stake. Actually, I think a lot of people have spoken on Mookie. I think maybe some of you may know Professor Mookie from Tata Institute. He speaks a lot on this. And my Vice President Raghuram also speaks. They gave me this slide here. Okay. But I think one has to understand the plagiarism is actually coming right from schools. I don't know whether some of you have you know, there's a DST project here, Inspire program, for example. And then there is program of projects, for example. I have been a referee in some of the. In one case, there were 400 people have been selected who have to be. They have made a project. These are 11th grade and 12th grade students. I refused to sign because all 400 were bought from small shops in Delhi for a few hundred rupees to a few thousand rupees, anywhere from up to a few thousand. So these fellows are 11th grade, 12th grade, have little solar cell here, and the solar cell is running a little machine there to pump water on something, and that is the project here. I refused. I said, they pleaded with me, please, for heaven's sake, Abdul Kalam is coming here to give an award here. We have to give the award. You please sign at least one or two cases. So actually, it's starting from schools. The projects are done by their mothers and so on. All the things are ratified somewhere else. Not only we, incidentally. Can you believe Oxford and Cambridge students do the same thing? Do you know who's earning from it? Indians. Indians are doing their projects and their reports, okay. A very large number, almost 30,000, I think, in the last few years, the Indians have done these projects for the Oxford and Cambridge students. So it's a very common. But it has all started from schools, okay. So we encourage them, parents have encouraged them, and so on. So I will skip that anyway. It's the same. हाँ जी कहाँ पे है अरे भाई यार आप भी करोगे कुछ ओके I thought I point out some of these are much more serious points to me as far as I'm concerned. These are some of the areas that I've researched which are very prominent today. and each one of them is really, I call them minefields of academic research ethics. They are really minefields. And that, I think the heads of department, the deans, the vice chancellors better worry about that. First is obviously IIT. I don't think I have to say, you see what is going on. It's really creating a major crisis. Artificial intelligence, data analytics, blockchain technology, these, as you see here, almost, I mean, the whole world is in today in turmoil here. How do you, privacy, for example, or any, I mean, you can literally manipulate a lot of things. Okay? Internet of things, of course, you've seen here, you can literally create wars today in cyber terrorism, wars. It won't take long. Fortunately, we are able to control so far, but it's going to be a serious matter here. Of course, the medical sciences are genomics, stem cells, and there are a lot of questions on that, ethical questions on that thing. Biodiversity, genetically modified food is still a big question mark, although a very large number of countries are already doing genetically modified food. USA does, China does, many countries, but in our country we have a very powerful scientist who have stopped it, and the government doesn't know what to do, which way to go about it. Very unfortunate, but without genetically modified food, we may not be able to feed 1.4 billion people, but then there are problems in it. Now, nanotechnology is an area where I've been also involved in it, and a lot of people don't understand its consequences. It's consequences in defense, in health and safety issues. Just to give you an example of that defense, which the Americans have even tried out. See, sub-micron particles, we only get 2.5 in Delhi, and I'm sure here 2.5 micron, that's a very thick particle. It's not that bad. The bad is 0.1 micron. Although the percentage is small, the 0.1 micron just goes in the bloodstreams. You don't have to do anything. So the Americans did that experiment some long time ago. They thought from aeroplane they dropped some of the particles in a place just to see what happens to the animals and so on. It goes right into the, and everybody, even human beings who are there, became sick. This is very serious. How do you detect a 0.1 micron particles? You don't carry around an electron microscope on it. So there are nanotechnology, there are a lot of safety issues there. In fact, the future wars may not be bought with the atom bombs and it will be with these nanoparticle bombs. That's all you have to do, throw a bomb on a city, everybody becomes sick. And that's all you need to throw there. So ecosphere, obviously you're hearing every day, carbon bombs, global warming and so on. Whatever we do, it has an effect on somewhere. Then we have space technologies. Well, you can see here space espionage, space wars. Now people, the Americans are able to see, or they did not see our first atom bomb, but they could not either somehow or the other. But in principle, within, I think the resolution is about what, 30 or 40 centimeters, for example, resolution. They can see anything within a 40 centimeter. They can really map out where Modiji is going. In principle, they are, so it's possible today. These are space technologies, because I think the future wars may very well be the space. I mean, you put something here in the space here and bomb out. Okay, so I think Chinese are already trying out. Americans, of course, have also trying out. Then obviously we have a lot of problem with the global wars. We just not nuclear bombs, there are nanotech bombs, biochemical bombs, chemical bombs. I think this is a matter of concern. And of course, the one which I think is probably the most serious, which IITs and NITs should look at it, is what do you do with the life of end of life products? A lot of people don't understand that at all. Can you believe we have 1.2 billion mobile telephones, right? We have in this country 1.2 billion mobile. Every 3 years, you throw away a battery, lithium battery, which we import. Every 3 years. So that means every year about 300 to 400 million batteries are being thrown. I was shocked recently. I was in IIT Kharagpur, and they told me that there's a place where they're dumping all these batteries, lithium batteries. Lithium is, first of all, rare anyway. We don't have in India. It's a very serious matter. So what do we do with the batteries here? And we are very happy to buying all the mobile telephones fine. And of course, now lithium batteries will be used in automobiles also. What do you do with that thing? Nobody knows. Nobody has done something good. That's not the only one. Of course, there are many other things and maybe throw away. Solar panels. We're talking of 100,000 megawatt of solar cell. The government doesn't tell you that. It's an area of my interest. There are at least 20,000 megawatts of solar panels today, which are not functioning well, which are functioning at half the value, one third of the value. in another few years they will be zero. IIT Jodhpur, because I am involved there, their solar cell panels are already working at 30%. So what will happen, all that glass, what will you do with that thing? Nobody has found out the way what will do with the glass. We have thrown away 100 million TVs, those big TVs. This has also been thrown. I'm sure some of you have thrown, but you didn't bother about where it goes. What happened to that glass? So these are the problems of not just fly ash we talk about, but plastics, electronics, batteries, solar panels, where will they go? We need a lot more research on that. Of course, this is not a very, you know, if a lab which brings you Bhatnagar Award, but this is a lab that these are the areas that we need to be worried about. Okay. Haan ji. Theek hai, aap hi kuch karte ho. Biochemical is not my field, okay, but needless to say, there are biofuels we are talking about, 3D printing of biocomponents now is already possible. Nanobiology is also the same problem. I think this is an important area which needs to be kept in mind, okay. There's another area which our engineers love to do their thing, and I'm not very happy. I demanded M-Tech project should be, at least half of it should be experimental. Well, you know, engineers from electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, they say, well, why only modeling is, and it was a battle in our sanity, you know, how much should be, it is a serious problem. We are allowing people to do modeling, and modeling you can do anything, whatever junk you put in, junk comes out, garbage in, garbage out. And a lot of our projects, a lot of our M-Tech theses, for example, are based on modeling only, and without understanding what goes on into things. This is very easy. You put in these parameters, change that. Okay. So mathematicians unfortunately helped in that process here. Okay. So this is a fallacy of misplaced confidence. I think this is a very serious matter. Okay. All right. I think sustainability, I've already mentioned here, all the we need to worry about the energy efficiencies, chemicals, ecology, I mean, that I've already mentioned, water resources, okay. Okay, I see. There is another issue which now the IITs and NITs are also concerned, and the government also wants you to be concerned to patenting, innovations. We talk a lot of innovations, and whether our innovations are useful or not, I think that doesn't bother the government. They only say, show us number of patents. And we can patent almost anything, you know. I should know it. I have several patents myself. I mean, the people who help you, legal people, they say, please put this in. This you have done, you can put this also. This is also feasible. I can tell you that. So they extrapolate it. So almost anything can be, without any verification, can be patented. Please take my word for it. I've been involved in patents, okay. And then if you have already a patent here, you just doctor a patent by changing a little bit of design. This is a very common sort of thing, okay. Of course, this has happened abroad, no basmati, haldi patents, for example, haldi patents. And here too, you change a little bit of basmati, that the Americans did it, and of course, CSIR fought the battle, but it's being done in India also. Medicines, for example, slight change in medicine, you do the patent, okay. There is a evergreening of patents with minor difficulty. Our DG of CSIR got into trouble, because he believed in evergreening. Evergreening is a process where your patent expires, say, after 25 years. You can modify a little bit and then green it for another 25 years. And that's what many of our industries which sell medicines in India, they are doing that, evergreening. This is obviously unethical, okay. And there are, of course, patent leaks. This is a stolen patent. This is between Japan and USA and Korea and China. I think that's a big problem. It's not a problem with us, Asi, because our parents, most of our parents are really no value. I mean, I'm sorry to say that, okay. We do that to keep our government happy. Modi ji becomes very happy, we have so many patents, but none of the patents is useful. And not even 10%, not even 1 to 2% are useful. The others are not useful at all, okay. Haan ji. Okay, so who cares for ethical value? We write to the head of the institution. They give a sort of answers, okay. They say, ignore, first they don't reply, unless they know me or they know that I'll not spare them. Then they say, oh no, it doesn't happen. Three universities wrote me, no, it cannot happen in my university. Then they diffuse, then they try to cover up, then they dilute it, and then dispose it, then defer it. Oh, we'll do it, we'll take it. I don't want to name university, but you know, 4 vice chancellors of central universities, we had to get them removed on the basis of this. But it took 3 years. Even the president wanted them to resign. I won't name the university. President said, let them resign. They are honorable people. I said, what honorable? They have done so much plagiarism. Because president knew them also, incidentally. Okay. He said, let them resign. I said, if you do their things, sir, we are going to put in newspapers of the president as so it's a very serious matter here that nobody wants to get in trouble their name, okay. Academies, MHRD, UGC, they are reluctant to, you know, even admit that such a thing exists, okay. So they say, well, what is there? Poor fellow has done something wrong here, let him go, let him, you know, be apologetic this time. They say it's not their problem. So this is a problem throughout the country today, okay. Haan ji. Okay. But I thought I mentioned to you globally this is a serious concern. And why is it a serious concern? Because on one hand we are all globalized, technologies are globalized, economies are globalized here, science technology is globalized, we interact, we compete with the world, we collaborate with them. We had a case right here in IIT Kanpur of collaboration and the fellow had to remove because there are a lot of things in involved in it. Intellectual property rights are globally, so we have to take care of the fact that we are part of the global warming. So destructive power of science technology driven globalism plus internetism is a global concern. This is economists are saying, serious people are saying, globalism, everything globalized, and also on the internet combined together is a very serious threat. Okay. Oh, I see. So it's a global scenario. Everybody is worried about it today. Throughout the world here, all the academies and similar institutions, say in Europe for example, they have given orders to all the universities that they have to have an ethics cell and they have to teach and so on. In USA, incidentally, all universities, all science subjects, including mathematics, for example, they have to, undergraduates or postgraduates, they must go through a sort of ethics course, okay. So it may be in a formal form, maybe informal form, okay. This is a responsibility of conductor research is mandatory now in most Western academic and R&D institutes. We have not been able to do that so far. 2 or 3 universities agreed to, and it's an irony. The university doesn't know how to examine these people. They called me, so please set a paper. Can you believe that a university vice chancellor said, please tell us how to set a paper? No, if this is the level of a vice chancellor, then what else do you expect? All right. Haan ji, boliye. All right. So how do we nurture these things? That's the question, obviously. Obviously, we have to nurture. First of all, we must see that it is something, it cannot be, you know, taught by from books and so on. It has to be cultured. It can best be taught, cultured, and nurtured in an informal way. I mean, it's a subject where, you know, discussion, happy discussion has to take place in an informal way through experience, analysis, introspection, sense of responsibility. I mean, you design certain, some questions of the type that has been raised here and say, okay, what will you do? So a student, for example, has a problem. I have raised some question here, and it has happened twice in during my deanship. A student has a thesis, he's done good work, but his supervisor somehow has become unhappy and says, I will not sign. Comes to me, what do you do? I've raised this question, I'm not answering that, I think you people have to answer. What will you do? As a dean, if you are a dean, what will you do with that? Okay. So I think things of that type are a thesis of a student is examined by somebody, and I'm not sure if many of you see theses because I've seen a lot of theses as a director. Of course, I always saw the reports of the thesis. As a dean also, I've seen thousands of them. A very prominent person, thesis a report comes from outside. It is obviously written by secretary, not by the professor. Professor has, you know, his initials are probably also the secretary. So, you know, it's always says good work. One of them said, well, the thesis doesn't deserve a PhD, but the poor lady has done, you know, has been suffered a lot at the hands of his supervisor. Supervisor should be punished, not the lady. She should get the PhD, but supervisor should be punished. What do you do? What do you do in that case? Can you believe the Houthi, in this case, the lady, she's the wife of a very prominent politician. Is in the news all the time. I'll leave that to you. So these things are dilemmas. But if I as a dean go to the director, I know that he says, oh, let us set up this committee, do this, go to the Senate. I said, nothing to him. I'm deciding. If you made me a dean, I'll decide. I think this is something else we have to learn, okay? We have to take this. You may be unpopular dean, but you have to do that, okay? So we should create suitable material. Actually, incidentally, material exists. I've given you some references, but I mean, there are only, I think, few books there, mostly in management. Management people have written a lot of books on ethics, okay? But we need more of the, there are some articles in Society for Scientific Values, if you see our website. There's a book by the INAE in which there's a big chapter written by me. So we have to sort of create case studies, okay, maybe hypothetical, that if that happens here. So I think it should be problem solving case studies, moral decision making studies, dilemmas, we have to create ourselves. Okay. But material does exist all over the world, okay. Americans really specialize. I think there are about 30, 40 books. But the best job is done by the Academy, US Academy. They have published a lot of books, very beautiful, wonderful books, okay, on the subject. But some of them are applicable to them, okay. But I think we need to do that. Essentially, we should do little modular courses in different areas, okay. And what the American universities do, their thing, they normally to give these lectures, they invite always a very prominent person who's well known, who's well respected. And what he or she does is, during lunch hour, they say, whoever wants to take this course is welcome. Doesn't matter whether you're first year or fifth year or something. Come under, if it's a good weather, sit under a tree and bring your back lunch and eat. And he says, this is this is a problem. What will you? So in other words, discussion takes place in a very informal way and under the leadership of a very prominent person so that his voice does make difference. I think this is the best model here, that make it that way, that don't make it so formal that people have to write an examination or something. So you can then create then hypothetical some cases, and so this is what the advice is, okay. All I will say is that our profession of teaching science technology, as I said in the opening remarks here, it's changing our lifestyle. Everybody, we are learning society. Our civilization is now dependent more and more on these processes, and they have to be ethical if we want to survive. So we have to dealing with internationally. We cannot simply say that we are ethical, but the world thinks that we are not ethical. I think this is true. So academic institutions must have in-house discussion on propagating and monitoring academic ethical values and issues through suitable committees, vigilance committees, knowledge integrity committees. This should be a part of that thing, okay. And mind you, there's a very important need, even though the government is sitting on a bill, they have not, every institution can have its own whistleblower rules, and if you have somebody, you have to protect them. And if you do that thing, many more people will tell you. It's from within the group, people will tell you that this fellow has copied it. It's from your own research group, somebody will tell you that, because otherwise you cannot find out. So this must be, this will bullshit. But Mark Twain says, be good and you will be lonesome. This is true, he said long time ago. But this is true, but then I think this is the sort of thing. I thought I put, this I'm sure you have seen on the internet, this cartoon. Have you seen it, all of you? Have you seen this? No?
Yes.
No, it's a beautiful. I was surprised. Here he says, he is giving an examination. He says, for a fair selection, everybody has to take this same examination. Please climb that tree. Let the IITs remember, let the NITs better remember. This is what we are doing also. So you see what will happen here. Is it ethical? Is that our ethical? This is a big question mark. You say, I don't know, whatever you want to go, but I think it's a very debatable point. This is why I think the American system, our students love that system, and they do extremely well. Why? Because they are given freedom. I've taught in Cornell, I've taught in 2-3 universities. I mean, I get students from God knows different department. They say they want to take this course. No, nobody stops them. So they come only when they want that course. And the degree should be a small amount of core values. And Swadhmaji, I'm professor, I have changed my mind. I would rather have no more than 30% of our credit should not be core courses. This is my view. And three or four NITs have followed my advice. I hope they are following it now, because we had a big committee and 30 to 40%, no more than that. The rest should be whatever they want to do. They could take a course in music if they want to, they could do it in chemical if they want to, they could do it in chemistry if they want to. Where's the problem? But on the degree or on the other side of the degree, write down these are the courses people taken. Why don't we learn to do that thing? Why do we have to be classical teacher or master of school or something? You have to do this. Only then you will get a degree. So this is, I think, so I raised this question, is this ethical? Okay. You have to, if you have any views on that, you can do that. Yeah? Okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. I've given you reading material and I've raised some questions also, but anyway, I think you got already questions. But I think there are some questions I really am something serious with. This is happening quite often. A student, PhD or M.Tech student, for example, or even B.Tech student, plagiarize, purchase thesis, if he has, what do you do? That's the question. So he's at the end of near world graduation, and you feel sorry, and somebody comes to you, "Arey Baba, jaane do, bichare ko." Question is, yeah, this is a serious moral question, ethical question here, and it is happening left and right. It's happening in all universities. Unfortunately, happening in some of the so-called prominent universities. Delhi University is a terrible thing. Delhi University has produced several vice chancellors. They are all now, I mean, later on people find out how much plagiarism they did themselves. So, Hani, okay, I think, all right, thank you very much, thank you. Have we done on time wise? I am not even looking at time. Okay.
So, that was really thought provoking. We have a few minutes for a couple of questions. If there are many more questions, then we will request you to continue in the afternoon.
You tell me, yeah, in the afternoon, and what? Here, right here?
At 4:30, we will.
4:30, okay. So you send some transport, will come. 4:30. Okay. All right. No, I'll be happy.
So, we have a couple of quick questions.
Are they supposed to answer all those?
4:30, sir.
These questions that I've given, are they supposed to?
They will answer them and give them to me.
I see. So you really make a student out of them. Okay.
any one question.
Is it good?
That's good.
Only one question.
Well, see, you gave me the command, I obeyed it, right? I was surprised that you.
No, I did not say I gave you the command. It was a suggestion. Keep our participants engaged with the subject. Yeah.
Okay, fine. So in the afternoon.
We take a break now and we continue our group.